negatively highlighted all these things. And we will highlight a couple of situations also. Dr. Lakshmi, this is another example, another collapse situation. A lady after a full dose of antibiotic collapsed. Okay. How do you view this situation and analyze?
Good morning, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes, yes. Lakshmi, go on.
My sincere thanks to Dr. Kunyumaydeen, Dr. Mumtaz, Professor Rajshekaran, and Dr. Lakshmi Amal for making me a part of this panel. Now, this is a very typical case scenario under consideration because the incriminating agent is injection cefazolin. And if one goes through the literature, it is very clear that amongst all the antibiotics, next to penicillin, cefazolin is one of the most frequently identified antibiotic in perioperative anaphylaxis. So we have an incriminating agent, and here is a patient who has suddenly collapsed. Now, most probably in this situation, because it has been given for a respiratory infection, I presume it has been administered in a ward where adequate preparedness would have been an issue. Here, the diagnosis of anaphylactic shock is not very difficult, but sometimes in the absence of typical mucocutaneous eruptions and a proper incriminating agent, a diagnosis may become difficult. So anyway, having encountered a state of collapse, the immediate management would be to remove the inciting cause. If it's an infusion or if it's a vaginal administration, the inciting cause should be removed as quickly as possible. Call for help. Now, because she is a pregnant lady and the uterus is big enough, put her immediately in the left lateral position. Otherwise, the person should be best nursed in the recumbent position with the lower limbs slightly elevated. And without wasting any time, administer the wonder drug, epinephrine, which is a drug of choice to be given in the case of anaphylaxis. I will be elaborating on the dosing and the administration shortly. Next, immediately have a quick assessment of the airway and respiration and saturation. See if the patient has any difficulty in talking. Inspect the oral cavity for any edema of the tongue, edema of the uvula, oropharyngeal edema, etc. And do not delay intubation, because once the edema sets in, the anatomy will be so distorted and intubation may become a problem even in the best of hands. So get a specialist involved if help is available, like an anesthesiologist, for immediate intubation so that the airway is secured. Next is volume resuscitation, because the next important thing that happens here is massive fluid shift from the intravascular to the extravascular compartment because of the increased vascular permeability. So fast infusion of IV fluids close to 1 to 2 liters in the next half an hour to 1 hour should be done. And the systolic BP, especially in pregnancy, should be maintained at least at 90 millimeters so that the placental perfusion does not suffer and the fetus is not compromised. Of course, most of us are so fond of giving bronchodilators, antihistamines, and steroids like Efcolin, but I've put this last because these are actually only adjunctives after the administration of epinephrine, which is the drug of choice. Now, for most of us physicians who are not used to emergency medicine protocols or in the department of anesthesia, we shy away from giving epinephrine, probably fearing the cardiac effects. But now, the one important thing here is the confusion regarding the dilution and the dosage and the route of administration. Now, I would say epinephrine is to anaphylaxis like how magnesium sulfate is to eclampsia. The first dose can be given without any consideration to the side effects or toxicity. So there are absolutely no contraindications for epinephrine in the context of anaphylaxis. Now, the strength of the solution does not come labeled on the ampoule. So if you find that the ampoule, which is normally available, is 1 mg/mL ampoule, then it is an aqueous solution of 1 in 1,000 dilution. Now, if the strength is 0.1 mg/mL, then it is a 1 in 10,000 solution, which is the cardiac epinephrine, which is given for the cardiac arrest. So here, this 1 in 1,000 solution, that is 1 mg/mL, can be loaded in a one cc syringe, and about 0.5 mg intramuscular can be injected deep intramuscular into the anterolateral aspect of mid-thigh. Now, why mid-thigh, not the buttock or the deltoid, is because the intense vasoconstriction could produce severe tissue necrosis. And most of them come around within the first dose itself, but if there is no response, it could be repeated maybe in another 5 to 15 minutes. And if multiple doses are required, then specialist help should be sought and an IV infusion should be started as per the protocol I've mentioned here. So do not shy away from giving epinephrine, even if it's a setup in a periphery, because once the diagnosis of anaphylaxis is confirmed, withholding epinephrine can lead to case fatality. So that may be the reason why many an anecdotal report of sudden collapse in peripheral centers is because probably one is not used to this particular drug, which is a lifesaver in such a situation.
Yes.
Now, coming to some of the fallacies in this particular scenario, I would say a complete history is most of the times lacking. A complete history with regard to previous drug sensitivity or allergy to drugs, or allergy to food or latex and other things, or the history of atopy or bronchial asthma. All these have to be very properly be elicited and documented in the case records. Now, what about the intradermal testing? Now, as far as experience and literature is concerned, most of the antibiotics, especially the beta-lactams like penicillins and cephalosporins, have the skin intradermal testing, the skin testing as the test of choice for predicting anaphylaxis. But even in the best of setups, the sensitivity amounts to only 70% of positivity. So in about 30% of them, the skin test will be negative. So a negative skin test does not guarantee against anaphylaxis. And that is one thing to remember. And if you're dealing with a drug which has a very notorious predisposition for anaphylaxis, like ampicillins, cefazolin, NSAIDs, oxytocin, misoprostol, iron sucrose, one should be extremely careful, even in the presence of a negative skin testing. The next important thing was to be aware of these drugs and the preparedness with an emergency cart to have these drugs, especially epinephrine, at hand. And one word about the LASA drugs, that is the look-alike, sound-alike drugs, because they are actually, because of the inadvertent administration of the wrong drug in a particular scenario. And a very notorious combination is one of bupivacaine with tranexamic acid. And there have been several reports in literature of inadvertent intrathecal administration of tranexamic acid, mistaking it for bupivacaine. In my own clinical experience, I have encountered two very bad cases of hypersensitivity to the Junax suppository, which is a diclofenac suppository, and misoprostol, which was actually given vaginally for abortion induction, and this patient ended up on the ventilator. So one should exercise extreme caution when using some of these drugs in our specialty. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Lakshmi, for highlighting, especially the administration of adrenaline and the LASA drugs. These are very important messages everybody has to incorporate into their practice. And we will have one more case before winding up, that is